Hello, good afternoon, everyone. We are starting a panel discussion on the main stage. If you're still around, come and check it out. My name is Kelly Dowell. We have a full panel here of industry experts and awesome people who have been innovating in this industry. Angelique, I just want to say thank you to the Synced team. You guys have put on an awesome, incredible event. It's been so much fun all day. I think everybody's pretty exhausted at this point, but we've got about 40 more minutes of awesome content here. So a little bit about me. I grew up in the green industry. My parents owned a landscaping company, primarily maintenance, residential maintenance in St. Louis, Missouri. So I started working for them. I worked for my dad. I wanted to answer the phones really badly. So they finally let me get on the phones. Did some administrative work, and then I kind of progressed into, I really like answering the phones because I like selling. I like providing solutions to our clients. Yes. And so that put me out in the field where I was able to get face-to-face with people and start selling them our solutions. And as the business grew, we hired more and more account managers and sales team and people like that. So I was able to become a sales manager, manage the account managers. And then there was a year that we did not get our H2B employees. So I had to take off my sales hat because clearly we needed no more sales. We had nobody to do the work, and put on a recruiting hat. And that's where I learned a lot about recruiting and taking what I learned from sales and marketing and making that kind of a recruiting principle. So I was able to traverse the industry and all of the aspects of what it takes to run a business. And I think one of the best things my parents did for me was to just allow me that space to grow and to innovate and to create new systems and to make mistakes. And I think, you know, that's why Angelique asked me. She said, you know, you've changed. And now at this point in my life, I no longer work for the family business. 6 years ago, I started my own company doing digital marketing and recruiting solutions for landscape industry professionals like yourselves. And so it's been really fulfilling to work with people like this who are changing the game of the way we do things. So I want to start by just having everyone introduce who you are, maybe where you started, because that's kind of my story. I started where I'm not at right now. And we'll just start with Jim on the end and come back this way.
Okay. Well, I'm starting off well.
He had a beer.
Actually, the funny story is I bought a beer over there, and Kelly came running over as I'm paying for it and says, by the way, you're on the panel now. Okay. So I think many of you saw me talking over there, so I won't elaborate too much on it. But my name is Jim McCutcheon. I own a landscape company here in Atlanta, Commercial Landscaping. And I've been in the business for 34 years. Clearly, I'm the old man of the panel today. And actually, I was just sharing a moment ago that when I started my career in 1989 as a salesperson for our company, I was in this very room in a 10 by 10 booth trying to sell to property managers. So it brings back a lot of memories. This is where I started, right here, Kelly.
Wow. Yeah. That's
pretty,
awesome.
Pretty full circle. My name is Jay Wirth. I'm the content marketing manager at Single Ops. I got my start in the industry because I was working an office job, and it felt a little bit like the movie Office Space. I was literally being asked for certain reports and this stuff, and I was like, this is insane. I have to get out of this. And there's a guy at my church that ran a landscaping company. I spent a summer mowing, and then I wanted more exposure to the industry, found a full-service landscaper the following summer when I was between semesters of college, and that really was kind of the launching pad. I remember very distinctly getting to a property that just looked like it was a vacant house, you know, like it was weeds up to your hip and just really a mess. And pulling weeds and edging and mulching and replanting and moving some plants. And by the time we left, it just looked like $1 million. And I was hooked on that like instant gratification, you know, right away. And I haven't really looked back. Tried forays into other industries, but haven't looked back much since then. Primarily my career has been in the green industry.
Wonderful. My name is Joel Northrup. I grew up in the Midwest. When I was about 14 years old, I started a lawn care company with my brother. And we, at first, it was initially just gonna be a way for us to save money for college. And we just grew that over the course of about 7 years. And we eventually got acquired by a larger company in the area. And I went into tech. But I wanted to get back into the green industry and build tools for to solve problems that my brother and I had when we owned our lawn care company. So I'm one of the founders and the CEO of DeepLawn, a software company. I'm based out of Austin, Texas now. So now I say y'all and act like I'm a Texan, but but I'm from the Midwest, so yeah.
Glad to have you. My name is Mario Camardella. I'm local, I'm from here, Sandy Springs. I got a mom from Texas, got a dad from New York, so we say we eat cornbread with our spaghetti. But when I grew up here, I went to UGA and I was studying to be an education major, had no idea what I wanted to do. I was gonna follow my father's footsteps, who was a woodshop teacher. And so, wasn't too crazy about it. Studying for a final, late one night, I run into my buddy who I graduated high school with. 1 o'clock in the morning, he was running into a building, and I was like, Charlie, where are you going? And he's like, oh, I got to finish my final. I'm like, it's 1 a.m., what are you doing? He's like, oh, I got to finish my golf course model before 8 a.m. And I was like, I got to see this. So I run with him. We go up to the fourth floor of Caldwell Hall at the University of Georgia. We go down this long hallway, open up this giant room, this studio, these giant desks. It was full of people. I just left the library. There was music, there was beer, there was dirty couches, nastier than my fraternity house, and people were sleeping on them. And it smelled like toxic markers, and I go, man, this is my tribe. Like, this, I'm home, this is where I wanna be. So right then and there, I found out about landscape architecture, totally, it unlocked all my love for nature. I was a Boy Scout, Eagle Scout, and it just enabled me to pour my passion into my profession. And that was the start of it. Founder, CEO of a company called ServScape, where it's a landscape marketplace, really bridging together local growers, local landscape designers, and local contractors into this website where you can procure all this stuff for our customers, which are largely homeowners. And starting off with a lot of other technological projects, one's called Scapeify, where we're doing this for other people. And then a new software project called eSolo, helping with inventory management of a lot of growers. So,
cool. So Mario, it seems like you have that tech mindset in the back of your head. You are a landscape architect by trade, but then you also put this into real life practices for people who are landscape company business owners, or even, you said, homeowners potentially. Mm-hmm. So how do you get that inspiration, and how did you kind of take that step from I'm a landscape designer, this is what I do, to now this is what I do?
So I had the fortunate opportunity to work for a couple of TV contractors. One was Mike Holmes. He had a show on Fox called Home Free. I've also worked for Netflix. I did a show called Instant Dream Home. HGTV shows, one's coming out in a few days. So they would tell you your project, and they would be like, okay, we're gonna approve this on Monday, we want it installed on Saturday. You mean like installed? Like, so you had your approval, so you had 1 week. So a lot of times, what we built ServScape was by necessity. So I had to have real-time availability of all these growers, have them all delivered, and have it everything in sync with the contractor. So all these, in sync, right? Synced live, right? So everything had to be synced for this, really, this thing to exist. That was just a blank slate just the day before. So. It was by necessity, and innovation really is rooted there.
Yeah, I think that's great. So, Joel, kind of the same question for you. Was your kind of leap born out of necessity? Because I think a lot of business owners and managers, we all have these struggles that we go through, and we're like, oh, here's that challenge again, here's that challenge again. So how do you get over that hump and just create a new system or a new software or a new way about doing things?
Yeah, so A lot of it was out of necessity. We needed better tools to be able to sell, especially during the spring. So we were in the residential lawn care space and in the Midwest, and about, as most lawn care people know, it's very seasonal. So for about 3 or 4 months a year, you get most of your leads, like 90% of your leads. So we wanted to build tools and or find them, and they did not exist. So set about to build them, and then, you know, got into tech to be able to build it then. So, yeah.
Yeah, that's awesome. Okay, so Jay, you are also in the tech space with SingleOps.
Yep.
What are some of those things that you guys are doing that are setting SingleOps ahead and in front of the game as far as technology and innovation go?
I I will preface this with saying I'm not actually a software guy. I'm a green industry guy that happens to work at a software company, okay? But I think one of the things that we're really doing, like Mario and Joel have spoken to, is we're taking a lot of customer feedback and figuring out where the pain points are, where are things not functional for them today that they need in order to grow their businesses. And so one of the sectors that we fit really well with is full service landscapers, but design build has been a little bit of a challenge there. And so we've got some functionality coming out later this year that's really gonna solve for that problem.
Awesome. All right, Jim, so we're back to you. So you self-admittedly claimed you're the old guy up here.
Yes.
Okay, proudly. But you're also a landscape business owner, and I think we all have a lot to learn from you here. One of the main questions and struggles that we're seeing again this year is in recruiting. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering what Highgrove is doing to make Highgrove the most appealing place to work and just showing the industry or showing these candidates what the industry has to offer.
Well, I mean, first of all, I think one of the things that we make a mistake of as an industry, and I've done it plenty of times for a long time, is that we believe that the only people that can work for this business are landscape people. And that's extremely limiting. I was talking to some gentlemen, my Michigan friends back over here a minute ago. We were talking about, finding salespeople, and he asked, should I get somebody out of college? Should I do this, that, and the other? And I said, well, you know, I wouldn't necessarily suggest your first sales guy coming out of college. I said, but most importantly, you've got enough people in your company that know about landscaping. What you need in a salesperson is somebody that knows how to build a relationship, somebody that's not afraid to stick their hand out, somebody that's not afraid to knock on a door 100 times and get told no, and is going to show up tomorrow morning and continue to do the same thing. So broadening our horizon as to where we're recruiting, I think, is one thing. Certainly, if you're trying to do a landscape designer or something like that, that's going to be difficult. Yes, indeed. But when you think about your finance arm of the company, when you think of sales, even operations, I mean, the number of people that are in logistics operations and so forth, a number of different ways to broaden our horizons. But most importantly, I think, as I was talking about earlier, from a differentiation standpoint, you have to show people why you're the place to be there. Our purpose for our company is to change people's lives in a positive direction. That says nothing about landscaping at all. That's not what our purpose is about. We have a tremendous amount of programs that we've put in place to help all of our employees. We have a matching program for college education savings and those types of things for our employees. And so it's finding ways to improve everybody else's lives while we work together to improve our company.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Can I dovetail with that real quick? I love what you said about finding people that maybe you don't have an industry background, right? That's actually how I got my first professional start in the industry. So I started in it in college, like I mentioned, and worked for some full-service landscapers. And when the recession hit in 2009, my wife and I lost our house. We had to relocate. And I put in an application grudgingly at Scott's Lawn Service at the time. And the sales manager there, he and I are still friends. We talk. But he called me and he said, hey, I'm looking at this resume and it's all over the place. Like, you've worked customer service jobs, you've worked in landscaping, you've worked all these things. And I was like, yeah. And he goes, I've got a fit for you. What I see is somebody looking for a place to belong. And I've got that fit for you. Why don't you come and talk to me? And I really didn't want to. I tried. Actually, Sunday night, I went on a job interview, hoping that I didn't have to start on Monday morning. And I'm so glad that I did. I think that's a tremendous insight. They don't have to be landscape people. Like, don't get those blinders on. I think that's a great insight.
I have a little vignette for you. Right across from our studio, or just two doors down, is this beautiful, this really cool, hip bar restaurant called Southbound. And there, my wife, all my friends, we love this bartender, Mike. And he would make the most complex drinks, and he knew everyone. He was friends with everyone. It was like, you know, it was the Sam Malone of the, you know, sort of, and just, but personality-wise, but also technically, he knew how to make these very sophisticated drinks and really got down into the cultural aspects of it. And he left. I remember going to his goodbye party, and we were like sad, you know, like he was leaving. And then 3 months later, Six months later, I see him in the parking lot coming into Southbound, say hello to some friends. I was like, dude, what are you doing? oh yeah, I don't like my new job. I wish, you know, I had something else. I said, dude, come work for me. Let's go. Because, and now he's really being this amazing coordinator for us. And he's really picked up on a lot of all the complexities of the plant as it has all these different layers and support. So we just were thrilled. All he's had to do is, I put everything into the bar nomenclature at first to really kind of learn the industry, and he's really thrived. So Mike, kudos to you, man.
Yeah, that's a really great and powerful story. And Jeff, the keynote, mentioned that there are some people, I do want to talk about technology and innovation, but Jeff mentioned that there are some people who are just technology adverse. And this is a great way, you know, we don't have to use all the best technology in the world. Sometimes the person for you is just like right here, you know? So I think that's a really great, great story about that. So are there other ways, like I know it's great to tell your story and make sure your brand's out there and get people from other industries to join the business, but like, let's get really practical and granular. How do we do that? You know, it's great to say, and I love it, and it's like, you know, find the great people who are bartenders or doing logistics or something else, but what are the best ways, technically, or maybe just reaching out or going to the gas station, but what have you found that actually works to get people into the grain industry? And anybody can answer this.
I'll share an insight that is not mine, but I will gladly steal it and give credit. There's a company in Maryland called Blades of Green. One of the lady that runs their pest control department, her name's Danielle Collinson, and they do all fertilization weed control and like mosquito control. It's all spread and spray stuff, right? And recruiting is a huge deal for them, and I could go more into this, but I think one of the key insights I took away, I was working at another company and we did a site visit and looked at all their processes, how do they have their truck rigs set up, to how do they do their routing and scheduling, to their HR functions. We looked at everything. They were very open about it. And one of the things that I thought that she said that was a tremendous insight is in the winter, when your salespeople are sitting around kind of twiddling their thumbs or maybe trying to follow up with some key accounts, but they're not very busy, she turned their inside salespeople into recruiters, into full-time recruiters. So you incentivized them financially like you would with a sale. You know, like they got referrals organically, or whether they got referrals through a job board or whatever, they were assigned to salespeople, and that salesperson followed up on it like it was a lead. Like, I'm gonna call you and make an intro. I'm gonna make sure that like when the offer letter gets out, I call you and follow up. Did you get it? Have you made a decision yet? Do you have any more questions? Yeah, I'll see about that extra 50 cents an hour you need to make this work. And when they brought people on, they were incentivized financially. And just that incredible, right? How cool is that? Next level. Because those people aren't going to be doing anything anyway. You're paying them to sit around. Or you're sending them on layoff.
It's also great because then once they come on board, they know somebody. They have almost that little mentor person that's there with them to walk alongside them who helped them through the hiring process too.
Absolutely.
Joel, you have a new business now, but you owned a landscaping company before and you sold it. Is that correct? Okay, awesome. So what would you say, like how would you encourage people, if one of the great ways that we're thinking outside the box here is get people outside of the industry, how would you encourage somebody who's outside the industry to want to join this industry? Because sometimes we get a bad rep. I was woken up this morning, you guys all probably got here before I did, but there was a landscaping company outside the Hyatt and they were using like 6 backpack blowers real loud. It woke me up, me out of bed. I mean, it's not necessarily a good reputation at times. So how can we encourage people from different fields to join us?
I think the way we frame our industry is it's just like plumbing and other technical fields, like plumbing, like electricians, one of the trades. And I know when hiring people, I know for me personally, I've made the mistake early on when I owned my company, I would hire people based on their skills and their past in the industry. And a lot of times that would be a big mistake because I was not hiring on the most important factor, which is, I think, their ethics and somebody's, you know, motives and what drives them. Are they an ethical person? Are they, you know, would I like to hang out with them? So I think first, like back to hiring, hire on, you know, ethics and somebody that has, you know, a good culture fit. And then, and I think equip your team. You know, some of the other people on this have hired a lot more people than I have.
and so I have more experience. But I know, you know, people in the industry like Joe Langton, you know, with robotics, some of the electrical equipment, equipping people with good tools to do the job well, I think is huge. They're not going to break their back pushing a huge, heavy mower. You know, they have a ride-on electric mower that doesn't take up much noise. So, yeah.
I think tools are very important. So that is an example of a tool that they're using on a regular basis. Another tool is the software that we provide. You know, SaaS, whether it's SaaS, whatever it is, but software using, Jim talked about they're switching to Aspire, switched to Aspire this year. But making the lives of our employees really easy, and whether that's starting with the hiring process, you know, I'm in marketing and I'm amazed by how many websites I see where the form to fill out just to apply is like 3 pages long. And it's like, how badly do you want somebody to work here? You know, clearly not that bad because they have to go through a lot of hoops to get in the door. So making things kind of easy for them, whether that's the tools that they use, like a backpack blower or a different type of mower, are really important. I think, you know, with the robotic mowers that we're seeing over there, that opens up a whole new world of job opportunities, because you're not standing behind a mower anymore or riding on a mower anymore, but you still need somebody to maintain that piece of equipment on somebody's grounds. And that's a different skill set, maybe a different brain set, is that a word?
Yeah.
That's required from those people. So what are, go ahead.
I'll mention too, so in the past, salespeople would have to show up to a property and they'd have to use a wheel and mark off a whole lawn. Today, with, you know, tools within a lot of the CRMs and tools like we work on a deep lawn, you can do a remote visit and spend more of the time actually talking and selling to the customer and explaining what the benefits of the company. And, you know, like you were saying, being a robotics technician, helping the robots mow and just trimming and maintaining those versus mowing the whole lawn is more attractive, I think. So.
Yeah, absolutely. I did want to offer this to the audience. There is a microphone right there. So if you have a question, maybe give me a wave or just jump up and interrupt us at any time. So we talked a bit about recruiting. Let's kind of shift gears and talk about just innovation overall with technology. So I know some of you guys have some tech products that are out there and that are helping that serve the industry. But what do you see as the biggest need? Maybe it came from a necessity, but we'll start with you. Like, what's the biggest need right now that people are looking for?
Well, as a practitioner, I had a design build firm, and I really wanted to know the real-time inventory from these farms. Had a relationship with these farms, and I couldn't get all this plant material to me, to my project. And before I launched ServScape, I served in the mayor's office as the urban agriculture director. And I realized that people needed fresh food access. They needed access and availability. And these are the two sort of central themes I found that's like through my life. You know, it's like one of those things that just got revealed. And so I was working on basically eliminating food deserts in Atlanta and working with communities that had limited access to fresh food. And that's the point. So I started coming up with, like, how can we create this digital farmer's market? Because I couldn't put a farmer's market on every street, on every corner. It was just such a pervasive issue. How could we use digital tools? And I found an organization called Common Market Georgia that was doing something similar on a commercial scale. And I just thought it was the most innovative thing, where they were selling stuff before it left the farm. They were selling to Emory, the food service, Emory, this wonderful agriculture of a Southwest farmer, African-American farmer, selling what they were growing before it left the field. And so this innovative procurement model, where you had showing the inventory, showing the availability, and then the distribution to bring that, making it accessible and available. And so when you do that with a big ecosystem like live plants and horticulture, you get a little bit more lead time than agriculture. Agriculture is cut, and you got like a very tight timeline. But with horticulture, you have a little bit more. The point is that when you have all these systems trying to work for the end game goal, which are these beautiful and resilient landscapes, it takes a number of components to make them work. Technology, through API support, through a lot of digital connectivity, essentially, we can limit the risks. And you can limit the risk and you can create more accessibility and more availability. And in this case, it was live inventory of plant material. So it's not just, at Surfscape, we're just, and I don't mean if this sound like a commercial, but this is why I'm so bullish on this idea. We're not limited by physical space, because these 30 farms that or 40 farms that we represent is thousands upon thousands of acres, you know, millions upon millions of GMV, all accessible in your phone right now. So all these plants that, you know, someone just order and they're delivered, so from a local source. So these technology things limit the risk. Nurseries don't have to hold so much inventory and just hope that it sells. It can now be more digitally connected and have these types of synchronizations with the system as a whole. Sorry, that was a little long-winded.
That's good.
That's really awesome. So you mentioned this word risk, and I was listening to Jim earlier. I don't know if you guys had a chance to go listen to him over there, and he said, there's a difference between scary and dangerous. And that really hit with me because, you know, it's a risk to be either a first adopter or even an innovator of these technologies that we're getting thrown into. So, Jim, let me ask you, you inspired me with this question. So, you know, how do you overcome that kind of fear? Is it worth the risk to innovate or take these chances and be someone who's going to be first into robotic mowers in your area, your demographic?
Absolutely. First of all, let me state, I find it fascinating that three gentlemen with industry experience are driving technology into this. You know, for the longest period of time, there was not a lot of innovation in our industry. I mean, it was, like I said earlier today, you got the zero-turn mower, and everybody thought, hey, that's the greatest thing in the world, me too, and you had 100 varieties of them, and that was about it. But when you look at this room and the things that are here, not only from a product-oriented type of thing, but also tools to help you grow your business that are now also cost-effective. Those types of tools didn't happen years ago. I mean, the most cost-effective thing you had to run your business was QuickBooks, and that was going to be pretty limited as to what it was able to do for you. And one of the easiest things to do, and we all do it, you walk these trade shows. Everybody tries not to make too much eye contact, because as soon as they do, right, that guy's going to go, hey, how are you? Yeah. I encourage you not to do that. One of the things I ask all of my people to do when we go to a trade show is find one thing in this space that we can make money with that we don't do today. Okay, so challenge yourself that way, because there's a tremendous amount of innovation in here. And so I can tell you there are things in here that I'm going to try. Do I know that they're going to work? I don't care. I'm going to try it, because if it does work, it's going to be wonderful. If it doesn't, I'll move on to the next thing. So you cannot be afraid to try new things. You'll learn more from failure often than you will success.
Jim, how do you determine that cost effectiveness? Like, okay, let's try, pick one of these vendors here. How long do you try them for until you decide it works or it's a bust or what? Or how do you determine, is this worth the risk?
Well, I mean, it depends on what it is, right? So if we're talking about a software system or something like that, that's not going to be a couple of weeks. I mean, that's going to take some time to see if this works. You got to put a lot of effort into it, this, that, and the other. If I've got some battery-powered equipment and I'm told this will last you all day long, and we go out there and it doesn't last me all day long, that's pretty
short
quick.
Trial.
Right. It's a pretty short trial. Right. So, but I do think establishing these relationships, even if you find somebody that maybe is onto something, you're not 100% convinced, but they got a really cool idea, stick with them. Keep watching, follow them, talk to them. I found some pretty amazing things over the years working it that way.
Yeah, I love that. What about you guys? What are some of the innovations that you're seeing that are coming to the green industry in 2023 and beyond? What is most needed?
So, something I'm excited about, I've seen a few companies in the industry that are developing this, and I don't think it's released yet, but there's a few companies that are releasing smart spray technology, essentially. And essentially what it is smart sensors that go on your Z sprays or your hose reel spray equipment. And in real time, they track how much chemical is applied and where. And I think I'm pretty excited about that, because from a management standpoint or an owner standpoint, you can in real time track numbers, better do job costing for spray companies. that are spreading chemicals. Also compliance too. So you have that data immediately. You know, you can put it into a report quickly and give it to the state or whatever, depending on what state you're in, the requirements vary. So I'm excited about that, as well as some of the AI technology. You know, we're developing a lot with AI, remotely generating measurements, and e-commerce, like what Mario's doing, the tools we're working on, e-commerce tools for lawn care, landscaping companies. In the world in which we live, where everyone is used to Uber, to Amazon, to these instant gratification tools, e-commerce, I think, is going to be more and more important, especially as, what is it, millennials and, I don't know, the Gen Z, Zoomers, as they age and own properties, I think e-commerce is going to be very important and making it easy for homeowners and purchasers to sign up and buy your services.
I think that's a really cool point. And one of the tools exist for the, like you're talking about, not just the monitoring of the product, but you can get data, real-time data on environmental conditions and soil conditions as well, right? So if you run a large commercial site, you're like, oh man, I gotta watch, conditions are right for a Pythium outbreak. I'm gonna be spraying a bunch of fungicide if I don't get in front of this, right? Those kinds of things are really cool. And actually kind of dovetailing with that, I think one of the things that we're gonna start to see, maybe not in 2023, but in the next couple of years, for companies that do a lot of commercial work especially, is you're gonna probably end up needing to either outsource it or have an in-house drone operator if you've got large commercial sites that you need to manage, because you get way better results looking at it at a bird's eye view. If you're talking large turf areas or things like that, or even snow, right? If you've got companies that are doing snow. So I think drone technology is actually gonna be a big thing.
What about you, Mario? What are you seeing for innovation in the future?
RFID, remote sensing, Internet of Things. So the sensory stuff, you know, some of the technologies that we're looking at is helping tree growers. Essentially, they want to, you know, they know that they have maybe 100 trees out there, and there's some percentage wrong. And so the idea is that the tree is usually kind of grown in batches, or you know, this lot over here or that lot, but really getting down to the identification of each tree, and then actually having remote sensing data to say, what size that tree is by its caliper, the sensing of the moisture, and then also the GPS, GPS tracking anything and everything. So just as much as I'm a new dad, I want to put like a GPS tracker on my kids. We want to, when you're dealing with big expensive equipment, mowers and to large trees, having that GPS. And then the last thing that I'll mention is the blockchain technology that exists within this. So you can imagine that if this RFID chip actually carries the life of that tree from liner to grower to maybe it's a college campus, and then you'll be able to track that tree through the life of that tree through cloud-based technology.
So along those lines, one thing I want to add, I've got about 100 trucks on the road every day, and last couple of years started having a lot of problems with rear-ending, all that kind of stuff, and there's 100%, I'm convinced, even though everybody swears it didn't happen, they're looking at these things when they're driving down the road, right? So I was desperately trying to find a way to solve that problem. Found a software you could put on this that when that vehicle was moving, this wouldn't work other than a phone call. I thought I'd won. Well, the problem is everybody has a personal cell phone too. Didn't solve the problem. I ultimately found a technology that has the GPS in it, forward-looking and cabin-looking cameras. But the interesting thing is it's got AI in it. So if you pick up your phone in the vehicle, it recognizes that's what you've done, and it starts to beep at you. If you put it down in 3 seconds, it's not going to do anything. If you don't, we're going to get a video clip of the fact that you're looking at that. You can get it to see whether drivers are getting tired, whether they're eating, whether they're smoking, any of the things that you don't want them to be doing inside of a vehicle to drive safety. I actually was shocked to find out how many guys weren't putting their seatbelts on. I mean, years ago, we used to have orange straps on all the seatbelts, so as they were leaving in the morning, you could see that those were on. Well, we stopped doing that. I don't know why. Now we got the orange straps again because we can see that stuff right away. So the AI and some of those other things are really trying to drive a safe work environment as well.
Yeah, I love all of these thoughts, from e-commerce to real-time data on soil conditions to chemical applications and tracking how much we're applying and cameras. And I think what this all boils down to is we're getting a lot more data, right? So what are we doing with all this data? Like, I think it's a big word in like tech industries, but is data for us, it can be used for safety, it could be a good thing. Does it ever become a bad thing? What do you guys think?
Well, I mean, bad data is really bad. You sell a plant that you don't have and you say you do, that could ruin somebody's job or day or job. So I think bad data can really be totally disruptive. But the other guys might talk about how else can be destructive, but I think it can be so enabling too, because you know what we built for Surfscape can literally, it took us 4 years and hundreds of thousands of dollars and developers and nights and weekends and blood, sweat, and tear, and then we can copy and paste it and give it to somebody within 3 seconds. Mm-hmm. And just change the logo and it's done. Like, you can have your own digital garden center in a day. So it's almost like, because once it's in the cloud, once it's sort of digitized, it's replicable so quickly. And I think that we're going to see such momentum and fluidity through the next generation of green industry people having these tools. So,
did you have something to add on data?
Sure. Yeah. What a lot of people don't understand about AI is that in order to build AI, it has to be trained on a lot of data, like enormous amounts of data. So I think for the most part, the data that all of these sensors are starting to gather, a lot of the robotic mowers now are starting to have cameras on them. That's valuable data that could be trained on future AI models to help predict, you know, what's grass, what is a weed. There's farm AI that as it's driving over, it can spot and pick out where weeds are and spray pesticide or herbicide directly on just those weeds rather than doing a blank treatment. So a lot of the data is very valuable and can be used to make our lives easier, but it has to be good data. If it's properly or improperly trained or labeled, then it's can actually cause a bad model to be built. So, but there's also privacy concerns. If those robotic mowers have imagery of a kid playing in the background, what are the ethics around that? Like, who owns that data?
That's it.
So that there's a conversation to be had about that.
Yeah. Okay. I want to kind of switch gears just a little bit. So there's a lot of talk, speculations about like a recession and raising prices and doing some, I think a lot of us are in renewal season. If not, they should probably be renewed. It's February. So, what are some processes that we can put in place or have to deal with some of these things like inflation, raising prices on fuel and even materials at times? What are some things that you guys are seeing or have been helping you?
I'm gonna let the guy that's seen a couple recessions go first.
All right, Jim, thank you.
I think the important thing about that is building a strong relationship with your clients. It will help you in the good times and the bad times. Mm-hmm. The folks that never talk to their clients and then walk in the door and say, hey, by the way, I gotta get a price increase, that's when you're gonna get somebody's gonna bid that thing out. So having that relationship is critical at all times. I also think it is important that we recognize that every one of our clients and customers and everybody else is going through some very similar things, but they are raising their prices. We are not indentured servants, okay? We are not required for the rest of our lives to sacrifice and suffer just to have the opportunity to work with somebody. It's got to be a win-win relationship, and that's what we try to develop with our clients. So the last 2 years, like I said, we've got about 600 commercial properties in the city that we maintain. We've gone through the last 2 years and significantly raised prices. I was sharing with some gentlemen, the average last year was 9.5%. That's the average. And we were able to demonstrate to them where the challenges are coming for us and why. And if anybody saw the graphic I put up earlier today, that really kind of helped to explain that. But more importantly, we were able to go into our customers and say, once again, hey, we've been here with you for years. Here's all the things that you've said you were trying to achieve. We're working on those things with you. Has anything changed? And if it hasn't, I'm not going to be able to keep up with what you need if I don't get this to be able to continue this relationship. We didn't get them all. Some of the folks, we just said, thank you. You got to go because I can't keep doing this way. And other folks said, hey, you know what? I can't do all that this year, but can you give me this year, and I'll renew you the next time, and we'll get the rest. Great. Let's work that out. But we've got to be able to address the things that are coming at us are real, and we cannot ignore those things.
And I think it's really insightful that in that you're talking about the scope of work. Like, you're reviewing the scope of work there, right? They're not just expecting the same thing. They're proactively saying, well, yeah, I can't afford all that. Let me prune some of those things out to fit in my budget. Like, you've laid it all out before them, and you're letting them decide what the priorities are. I think that's a really insightful point.
Yeah,
and that's a huge challenge, especially you're in the commercial space, and that's...
I mean, look, I can guarantee you, it gives people in here indigestion, the idea of raising prices. Everywhere I see that, everybody talks about it. It did for me, too, for years, but I recognize that, you know, if we're going to be healthy and be able to solve those problems and take care of our people, you have to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I also think that really goes back to being able to properly tell your story and understand your purpose.
Yes.
And why you're in business. It's not about the money, but, you know, what we're doing and the people that we're helping. One of my favorite people to follow is Mike Rowe. Have you guys heard of,
yeah.
You guys know Mike Rowe and the Mike Rowe Works Foundation. And he's done a tremendous job just highlighting blue-collar jobs and creating scholarships for individuals who want to work in blue-collar industries. And so I think that to me is really good. He helps us in a way that tells our story. So it's easy enough if you are a dental assistant or an accountant, or, you know, people know what those things are. But saying, like, I'm a landscaping professional and making that really clear to the world around us and maybe that's outside of the industry is something that I really like to ask people about. So what are you guys saying when someone's like, give me your elevator pitch? Like, what do you say that you do, and how do you relate that to, you know, in layman's terms, what your work is in the green industry?
It always depends on the audience.
That's good. Good point.
But a lot of times, you know, I'm very proud of the fact that I'm a landscape architect. I went to the school. I graduated. I worked for a landscape architect. I took the test more than once, and and finally passed.
By the way, I noticed you didn't say passed.
And passed. And so I have these little initials, and I'm very proud of it. My mother's very proud of it. So, you know, that was a sense of accomplishment. And you know, a lot of people will be like, yeah, great, you're a landscape architect. Let me tell you about this little patch in my lawn that I need you to look at. I mean, that's usually what I get. And my wife, you know, promptly kicks me under the table and, you know, reminds me to really just take it as an opportunity to really kind of focus the attention on what they do and how maybe landscape design or landscape architecture or some sort of the green industry affects their lives or jobs in some way. So really just bringing it to whoever I talk to rather than, you know, try to explain that they don't know who Frederick Law Olmsted is and they should, you know?
Yes, Olmsted. So. I'm a huge Olmsted fan, by the way.
All right, I want to hear this question from all of you. So what's, you know, not necessarily your elevator pitch, but how do you show pride in what it is that you do and about our industry?
I have to be honest, when I was in high school and college, like for a little while, I was embarrassed to tell people I'm in the lawn care space, I own a lawn care company. They'd look at me like, oh, okay, you mow lawns, you push a mower. But since then, a lot of my best friends and closest colleagues own lawn care businesses or have scaled lawn care businesses, landscaping, or own nurseries. And there's a lot of pride in being a part of this industry. So like we were talking about earlier, it's important that we continue to, like as owners, we help, you know, we take care of our employees, we pay good wages. It's important. I'm an investor in a lawn care company in the Houston area, and we start by paying everyone $22 an hour. That's our minimum.
Wow, $22 an hour minimum.
It's a stretch, and it's not easy, but with technology and innovation, we've been able to still be profitable. So I think starting off paying people well, it'll continue to grow the way the industry is viewed.
So let's hear it, Jay.
So for me, and this I think ties back into what you were talking about earlier, how do you draw people in from another industry maybe? How do we talk about it? And I think this is one of the things that as an industry, we're pretty awful at. And I think that we have so much room to do better. Because you're all sitting in this room right now because you love the industry. You didn't sacrifice time out of your day to come here and sit here and listen and get education and hear from other professionals because you hate doing what you do, right? One of the coolest days, and this is a story I tell, one of the coolest days I ever had at work, I was working for a company in Pennsylvania. Wheatlands is James Buchanan's presidential homestead in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. And I got to spend a day, there's an arboretum on the grounds of a presidential homestead, and I got to spend a day helping treat trees on that property for emerald ash borer. And so the state champion ash tree is on those grounds. And the system we were using, you drilled a series of holes around the trunk, and then there's these needles that go in, and then there was a pressurized bottle, and you flipped it over, and the tubing was clear, and you could watch the insecticide being drawn in by, I could watch this 200-year-old tree on a presidential homestead drinking in its medicine. We don't talk about those days, right? Like, we don't talk about how fun that is when we're talking to recruits or when we're giving the elevator pitch. Yeah, I'm a landscaper. Like, tell those stories about why you do what you do. And so for me, what I do at Single Ops, I have very little to do with the software. They brought me in because I have those types of experiences. And I've spent time day to day working in these businesses to create resources to help you run your businesses better. I want you to win. I want you to grow. I want you to scale. I want you to create more jobs. I want you to plant more trees. I want you to introduce more people to the industry so that it's sustained long term. That's what gets me up in the morning. So when I tell people about what I do, that's what I do. I help businesses win so that more people can treat the state champion ash tree somewhere in their area.
Jay is not passionate at all about the industry. Jim, talk to us.
So I just tell you, from a personal standpoint, I'm an incredibly blessed man. I'm not the brightest guy in the room. I've made a tremendous amount of mistakes. I've been in this business for a long time. When I talk to people about what I'm most proud about, I have a tremendous amount of people that have been 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, and one in particular, 34 years, and it's not me, has been with me all that time. But more importantly, I have 16 second generation people that work in our company. So that's the stuff
that's
I get
incredible.
Proud about.
Yeah. Yeah, that's yeah. Awesome. Yeah. All right, well, Mario, Jay, Jim, Joel, it's been awesome hearing from you guys. I am Kelly, so we have awards in 10 minutes right here. Actually, I'm lying. It is right now, so don't go anywhere. And there was something else I was supposed to say. Is that it?
Get off the stage.
Oh, I was going to say that everything's recorded. So everything has been recorded, and we will get a copy of these. I think that's all I have to say. So thank you, guys.
Thank you so much, everyone. Did a great job. Be careful. Yes, and so we have our inaugural Synced Awards that we'd like to announce just before everybody heads home, wherever you're going. The first one that I would like to announce is the Environmentally Synced Award. This award, we had people get nominated, or you could nominate yourself, and fill out what you're doing to help the environment. This award was sponsored by, where is he? Bob, do you want to come up and say a few words? So Bob Hawkinson from Recede Bioplastics has a great, lots of products that you're putting out there, or
say
no,
quick.
I don't. Say a few words, but
hey, y'all.
Sponsored the award.
Yeah. We sponsored a sustainability award, and we appreciate what everybody's doing out here and all the really cool, innovative things that are happening. We hooked up because we met at a show where we were rolling out our, we have patents on all kinds of biodegradable plastic and lots of applications within our industry, such as weed eater string and burial pots. We get rid of agricultural plastic. We've filed on irrigation flags that are biodegradable, so you can run them over with a lawnmower, mulch them up. Lots of things, ag film, mulch bags that break down, that block weeds, get rid of Roundup, and get rid of plastic bags. So I've been in the landscape industry and still am for 40 years. I'm a commercial contractor. Jim, I think you might be less than me. You probably don't remember me, but it was Symbiote, wasn't it? Bob with TLC. Yeah, way back when. So, been around at a long time too. But it's a really cool industry, and any of the young folks or newbies or starters or whatever, it's a really cool opportunities. And what's neat about this industry is you can go 40 different directions, and it's just there's vendors, there's providers, there's installers, there's designers. Just the whole industry is really cool, and it only works because there's so many people like this that are just doing really good things. And thank you for everything you're doing. You're doing really good.
Thanks, Bob. Great
show.
Thank you for sponsoring that award. And the winner is, drum roll, or no. Okay, no drum roll. Patrick from Lawnark Eco Weed Killer. Can you please come up and receive the award? Thank you so much for being a part of the show, and congratulate you on your award.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Patrick. So we have the next award is Newly Synced. These are companies, landscape companies, that are less than 5 years old in the business, but have shown innovative thinking. Well, I guess that's innovative leasing. But a lot of great progress in the industry and are doing great things. The award for this, the sponsor for this award, thank you very much, is Jeffrey Scott Consulting. And the winner of this award will also get a ticket to his summer summit. And I have more information on that. It's a 2-day event up north.
Hey guys, I'm Anne-Marie, and I'm here to present the Newly Synced Award. Like Angelique mentioned, this goes to a company that is new, less than 5 years old, and someone that we believe has become a steward for our industry. So the company, or the person that we've chosen for the Newly Synced Award, has been in business for almost 3 years, did 100K in sales in their first 100 days of business, and really has provided a platform for growers, designers, and contractors to connect with consumers and other businesses. So we're really excited to present the Newly Synced Award to Mario Camardella. It's like every Family Gathering, you know? There's way too many photos. Thank you. And now, Amy, to present our Innovatively Synced Award.
Hey, y'all. This is loud. So this award is going to, the idea of it, it's forward-thinking leaders adopting new concepts, new ideas into their businesses, and applying them to the industry, how it could better not only, the systems, the community that it serves, but also the businesses that utilize it. So this company has been in business for 25 years as a commercial maintenance landscaping company out of Chicago, Illinois. They have also implemented and designed robotic mower systems. They have also and are currently doing projects with Building Green Magic Homes. He has also built the first green zone in the USA with AGZA. He also has a podcast system, so staying very innovatively called Automated Success Podcast. And that award is going to Joe Langton. Joe Langton is not here right now, but his daughter, Julia Langton, will be receiving the award on his behalf. All righty, thank y'all.
If we could have all of the award winners up, we're gonna take a little group photo. Thank you guys so much for being here today. We really appreciate it.
One last thing, in the true sense of being sustainable, we are collecting these tags so you don't throw them away. If you want to keep them as a souvenir, and you will keep them, then do that. But if not, you can leave them at the registration desk so we can use them again in the future. Thank you. Thank you for coming.